Hi, my name is Isabel Leonard, and this is Living the Classical Life.
Thanks so much for being on.
Thanks for having me.
So take me to the beginning. So you were born here in New York City. Mm-hmm. Did you have a musical family?
I would say I have an artistic family, or an artistically inclined family. My father was a visual artist, and my mother, she has her PhD in physics, which she finished here in the United States when she moved from Argentina. But she is the one with the specific love of opera. And she sang as she was growing up in Argentina, loved to sing, and it's always been a love of hers. So she's the one that listens to opera and has WQXR playing all the time at home. So I grew up with that.
At what point did you realize that you have a voice? Or was it other people?
It's always a hard question to answer because I think as a child, at least for me, I just went doing what I enjoyed, and art, fine arts and music were where I was happy and where I seemed to excel in the, you know, in the spectrum of the group that I was growing up with. So for me, it was what I enjoyed to do, and I sang at home. My mom and I sang together. I mean, I think it could be anything from a round of Row, Row, Row Your Boat to little Spanish songs, or my dad liked to sing. Being involved in the arts was just a part of our lifestyle. So it wasn't like one day I woke up and I thought, I have a voice, so I'm going to use it. It was, I think these things develop slowly. I started dancing when I was a child, when I was five. My mother enrolled me at the Joffrey Ballet School, and I did ballet for my entire youth. And that was really the foundation, I think, of a physical discipline for me, first before voice. And so that, you know, teaches a child rhythm and how to use their body. And you learn what you learn as a child. It's different. It's an unconscious learning, I think. So that went on and evolved then into more singing, and I sang in the choir at school. And then my mother found out that she's a pretty big influence on my education, only because she's very opinionated, and which is good. And she found out that Manhattan School of Music was starting a children's festival course. And Christine Jordanoff would commute from Duquesne University every Saturday to teach a group of students to be a children's festival choir. And that was where my love of singing, I think, really blossomed. She was an incredibly kind woman, and we sang music that was appropriate for the children, for our age. We learned a lot about harmony just by being there. A lot about theory, again, just by being there and through the exercises that she taught us. And we learned a love for music, a real joy in singing. I mean, the joy exuded, I think, that came from this children's choir was palpable. And I had one friend, Penelope, and she and I used to walk home together after, as we were older, in, you know, because I stayed for about 5 years through the beginning of high school. And as we were older, we would walk back to my home together, and her mom would come and pick her up, and we would sing the entire way home, so from MSM all the way down. By then, we had moved from Chelsea to the Upper West Side, and we would sing all the way home. you know, and it was the greatest time. I just remember she and I loved singing in harmony together. So, I mean, that was a beginning for me. So I did the chorus, and then I decided I wanted to go to LaGuardia High School for singing. I auditioned for music and art, or rather for visual arts, is what I mean.
It's a school for the performing arts.
It's a school for the performing arts. They have dance, visual arts, acting, their instrumental, and singing. Everything under the sun that you can think of in terms of performing arts, including the visual arts. And I was accepted for both visual arts because I had prepared a portfolio. My dad had helped me with that, and my art education through elementary school was really strong. And I sang, I did an audition for singing, and I decided to go for singing. And that was sort of the beginning of more official music education, even though it's still high school, and so I sang a lot with a jazz band, I did a lot of musical theater, but I sang with a choir, I learned more classical repertoire, more of the, you know, the tried and true Italian art songs, which then enabled me to decide that I wanted to try out for conservatories for college. And I auditioned for a lot of different places, and one of which was Juilliard. And I narrowed it down to Juilliard and to NYU, to CAP 21, their musical theater program. And I spent a day at each place to try and feel out where I would be most comfortable, because I really wasn't sure what medium I wanted to go into. There wasn't a, musical theater was just as important to me. I mean, it was the music. For me, it was about the music. So if there had been a school that had said you could do both, I would have gone there. But I thought that I should then go to Juilliard and learn how to produce my voice correctly and in a healthy manner. And that was how I made that decision. And also, I, for whatever reason, you know, that day, I had a better experience with the students that I met at Juilliard than I did at the ones at NYU, for no other reason than it was just the way the cards fell. And then that kind of started the rest of it.
There are so many discussions about the role of arts education in schools. Mm-hmm. Having been through a performing arts high school, how essential was that for your personal and artistic development?
That's a tricky question to answer. It's kind of loaded. Well, I think I mean, I think I can say kindly that I didn't leave LaGuardia with a vocal technique, which I don't think a high schooler necessarily should leave high school knowing how to really use their voice. I think that it's one of the mechanisms that develops a lot later in life, and it's okay not to have a voice teacher until you're older. So for me, it was about being exposed to the music, being exposed to all of this choir repertoire, being able to sing the solos as I got older and was in my junior and senior year, and being around students who all had something special about them. Mm-hmm. They had a strength somewhere. And I feel like as a student body, that for every student that you meet or come across to have this, even if it's just one strength, it was a positive atmosphere for me. It was very positive. And then holidays were a lot of fun. Like Halloween was a whole lot of fun there because everybody came dressed. I mean, and there was no, I mean, I may have been really lucky. I may have gone through high school with blinders on, but I don't remember there being cliques in high school. There weren't like the jocks or the popular girls. And even if there were, the school was so big that it didn't matter. So lunchtime was not stressful. You know, walking down the hall was not, you know, there wasn't any of that weird drama. No, we didn't dance on the tables like they do in Fame. But there was that sense of camaraderie, I think, between the students in the same division and the students on a whole. And that was, it was already, you know, the mini microcosm of being out, I think, in the art world, and you meet all these different people and what they do. And now it's really interesting to start seeing whether some of them have pursued their major or not, and what they're doing with their lives. But you know that they still keep it in them somewhere.
You had basically just one voice teacher. Is that usual in the world of singers?
I didn't have one in high school. I was it didn't come up as something that I wanted a teacher because I thought that I should have one. I thought, you know, some of my friends had voice teachers, and I thought maybe I should have a teacher. But my this is another thing that my mother did. That my mother said, no, you're not. You don't need a voice teacher right now. You let yourself develop naturally and go from there, which was great. I think was the right choice, and because I wasn't being confined yet, as I was still physically developing, you know. So by the time I got to Juilliard, I had Edith Burrs, you know, and she's been my teacher ever since I walked in those classrooms. And I sang for her before I auditioned and, you know, did like a consultation. And I still see her to this day. I don't see her with as much frequency as I'd like to because of travel and work. But I do see her and speak to her and email her and talk to her about everything. And she's very much a part of my decision-making process and life in general. She's been a wonderful teacher and a wonderful life coach, too.
I get the sense that the best teachers don't just cover music. So what was Edith Burr's influence on you?
There have been a few people in my life that have had incredible positive energy to them, about them, and she's one of them. I don't think I've ever seen her since, I mean, I met her when I was 17 and I'm 32 now. So in all of those years, I think I've seen her peaked, you know, peaked with upset, maybe once. And she's never been frustrated with me in a lesson. She's always been nothing but generous and open and giving. And that's an incredible consistency there. I mean, it makes you want to be a better, not only person, but a better singer and just, and give your time to her as well. You know, it's like mutual respect without talking about it. And she gives it in spades. And to all of her students, she just has a very, aura is a funny word, but she has a wonderful aura. She's kind, and she always knew if I came into my lesson and I was a little bit off that day for personal reasons or whatever, and she would just look at me and she would say, how are you? You know? And if I was fine, I was, oh, you know, I'm fine, just a little stressed or blah, blah, blah. Or I would fall apart into tears for whatever reason. And we would talk for a few minutes and she would accept and acknowledge whatever it was that was going on. She wouldn't necessarily give me specific advice as to what to do, but she would enable me to go through the process and figure out what I needed to do and guide me along, you know, so that I could make the right decision ultimately. And then we would get on with our lesson and it'd be great, you know, and it was, and you never felt like what you were feeling or what you were doing was wrong or not welcome. And I think as an artist, it's so important to feel safe. You know, I think the minute you feel that you're not safe in an environment, especially as a young developing artist, you aren't free to experiment, you're not free to make a mistake. And so she really gave that environment to me to be able to learn, which is huge.
That seems quite different from some of the pedagogical traditions that seem to say, let's toughen up the student so that he or she can survive the world. Do you think that this certain sense of optimism in that case is absolutely essential?
Being positive is really important. I mean, why not? Like, what's the point otherwise? I mean, it's for me, it's like performing. If you're not going to have fun, why are you doing it in the first place? So I think if you're teaching, you have to, and you're teaching. I mean, I've come a long way from being in school to being a performer and then understanding the difference between the two institutions. There's a very clear difference between an educational experience and working. I think they both cross the lines, but school is school. And I think as somebody who I like to educate, I like to teach, I like to do workshops and master classes, I feel like if you're teaching and you're setting up an environment that is so stressful for the student, there's just no way that they can find out who they are. I just don't think it's possible because they're so stressed and so locked up And it's, you're going to get a lot of that in life. You're going to get a lot of that in performance. There's plenty of people that will critique you, and your own self-critique is so strong that I don't think in an educational environment it's necessary. I just don't think it is. I think it's fine to, when you're done singing or performing, and that has come off, you know, the adrenaline has worn off, the fear has gone away, or whatever it is that you were experiencing at that moment, and you are sort of back to being your public person, or your, I wouldn't say public persona, your sort of day-to-day persona, then you can talk about the reality of the business, and then you can talk about the harshness and things that may need to change or shift, or what you may need to do better or not. But I think at that moment, at that vulnerable moment that every artist is in while they're trying to do their art, it's not the time. I just don't think it's the time. For me, I don't think it's the time.
At a young age, you're already known as a singer who defies categories, whether it be male or female roles, or singing as a mezzo or a soprano. Mm-hmm. You're singing Cherubino at the Met right now in The Marriage of Figaro. How do you prepare for such a complicated role, a pants role?
Well, Cherubino and I have sort of been friends for a long time now. I've been performing him for several years, and I've done several different productions. And with a character like Cherubino, it takes time. You just have to develop through him, and every production informs you a little bit more, gives you new vocabulary, new physical vocabulary. When it comes to Cherubino, though, I mean, I started singing pants roles and working on him when I was still in school, and it was very interesting to me physically to develop him as a boy, as a young man. And so I remember in school, I used to walk from one end of the dance studio to the other and look at myself in the mirror, how I was walking. And I would, but I have to say that the biggest, the most time that I spent developing Cherubino came from observing the men in my life. So, and mainly the men in the productions that I was in at that time. So, especially in the beginning, when I was still trying to find a physical vocabulary with Cherubino that would come naturally to me. And so I would watch whoever was playing the Count or you know, whomever was playing Figaro, and watch their physicality as men, and how they would sit and how they would walk and where they put their hands, and when they spoke, what did they, you know, what would they do if they caught something, how would they catch it, how did they kneel, you know, lots of these little details. And I would just observe it, continue to observe it. And then I actually did most of Cherubino's physicality away from a mirror after that. I stopped looking, because I thought, if I look too much, I'm never gonna just feel like what I'm doing is okay, because I'm gonna want that sort of look. And sometimes if I'm going for a very specific physical gesture, I will go to a mirror and I will look, because a lot of times I think I'm being a certain way, but then when I get in front of the mirror, I realize that it's as if the volume is not loud enough. So I have to figure out what is it in my kinesthetic sense that is not translating, boost it up and look at it in the mirror and think that's what I'm going for, and then try to feel it in my body and then just get away from the mirror in order to recreate it. That's sort of the process for me.
Did your work as a dancer factor at all into this observation of body language?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think unconsciously, it only became a conscious effort while I was, particularly with things like Cherubino or any of the pants roles. But I think that the physical discipline just has enabled me to feel comfortable using my body in different ways.
Do you feel like it's easier for you to play one type of role as opposed to the other? Do you feel more comfortable or less comfortable in these pants roles? You've played quite a number of them.
Well, for me, everything comes with time. So, and I know that about myself. And so if I've played a role several times, I really develop a familiarity. Can't speak. A familiarity with the role and with the character. And that comes with time. So for me, if I can repeat something I know that it will sink deeper and deeper and deeper. In terms of whether something's harder than another, they all have their different challenges. I think the biggest challenge for me playing any role is what my head and brain thinks of the character and how it judges the character or how it interprets or perceives the character versus who the character actually is, because they're different a lot of times. And if you're playing a character where your mind does not meet eye to eye with the character, the first thing for me is to find a way of meeting eye to eye. Because if you're gonna play the character, you have to be that character. You can't be fighting yourself throughout the show. It doesn't work.
You're gaining so much exposure around the world through these Metropolitan Opera HD broadcasts. Mm-hmm. Does that add a different level of nerves when you know that are you addressing a wider audience beyond the one that it's in front of you?
Yeah, I think it would be silly to say no, because I mean the reality is that if you really think about it, you have the entire audience that's in the theater, and then you have everybody that may be in a movie theater watching. So yeah, the reality is there are a lot of people watching. But I've gotten to a point at least now where, I mean, you can let it throw you, or you can just think, well, it's just a lot of people, a lot more people. I mean, there are already so many in the theater of the Met that you're kind of like, well, what's another 10,000 people at this point? You know, I mean, it's a great opportunity for everyone, I think, to be in that at the same time. I think if anything, you just have to think of it as this big community all over the world that's getting to experience something at the same time, which is a very new, only of this age thing. And so it's fun. You have to think of it as just like a fun giant living room.
That first time when you walked onto stage at the Met, mm-hmm. did you feel psychologically ready for that level of exposure?
Oh, psychologically? I don't think I've ever felt psychologically ready for anything. I mean, I think that there's always a part of any artist that thinks, oh no, why am I here, why did they hire me? Why did they hire me? Surely they made a mistake, surely. Yeah, I mean, we think that all the time. I think it's just part of who we are. And the only way, at least for me, to combat any of those feelings is just to say, well, I've prepared myself, I've done my homework, so to speak, I've rehearsed, I know how to sing this, this is what I'm doing with the piece, this is what I'm doing with the character, so that's what I'm gonna do, and just do it.
In the moment that you're on stage, how do you resist assessing how a performance is going as it's happening?
Oh, it's really difficult. I mean, every single performance is different. I mean, if you allow it to be different. I like it when things are different. I try not to repeat the last performance, because then that's when I find myself judging it even more. I think once I stopped trying to reproduce something that I've done in the past, I actually stopped a lot of that self-critique in the moment of a performance, because you're allowing yourself to create something new and fresh every time. And if you're not trying to recreate something, you have nothing to base what you're doing as a comparison to. You know, you can't compare it to anything else because you've chosen not to. And that's very helpful to me. I think also with a character that I know so well, like Cherubino, it's easier not to judge as I go along, because there's so much more in the grand scheme of the opera that I'm interested in and that I enjoy. So it's easier for me to just enjoy the moment. With a new role, though, where you're probably still thinking about the text in a more, you know, analytical way, and you're thinking about your vocal technique, you're thinking about the staging, or whatever it is, no matter how much you've rehearsed, a new role has that, I think, a slight lack of depth to it, which is not a negative thing. It just means that it hasn't completely entered your body yet. And it's only natural, and it's perfectly normal. And I think in those situations, there may be a little bit more, you know, self-critique, the little voice in your head that's like, oh my God, the high note's coming up. You know, but you also know as a professional that not only can your colleagues read it on your face, but if somebody's really looking at you from the audience and you have that thought go through your mind, you go from being really animated and talking to this person and saying, this is how I feel, and this is what I'm singing about, to this is how I feel, and this is what I'm singing about, because you're actually thinking about the high C or whatever that's coming along. So it's your job and your duty not to, you know, or to try not to, at least.
So it's one thing to deal with that self-critical voice. Are you ever afraid of criticism from the audience, or critiques, or newspaper reviews that say aren't necessarily positive? Of course, you've had many positive ones.
Well, the subject of reviews.
Reviews,
everybody has an opinion. I think that's all I'll say. Everybody has an opinion, you know?
Right.
And I'm past the point in reviews where I think one person's opinion should matter more than anyone else that was in that theater. Because everyone is there for a reason. They want to be there, or they love the piece, or they're there specifically for an artist. And if they loved it, they loved it. I don't think that anybody else should tell them otherwise. I think I've had this conversation a lot recently about reviews in general, mm-hmm. and it's a reflection. My ideas about this are more of a reflection of where we are in our time with this particular art form. Opera is not a mainstream medium as it once used to be. It's not as easily accessible, although there are lots of things like the HDs and DVDs now that have come out because of it and all of this that are allowing it to be more accessible to the general public. But because it's not on TV every day, and it's, you know, it's just not that kind of medium, I feel like the responsibility for everyone who is not on the stage should be in positive reinforcement of the art form. So it doesn't mean I'm against a negative review, but I am against reviews that can kill somebody's spirit mm-hmm. as an artist, or that can create such a negative cloud, or be so impactful that the audience comes in feeling that way or expecting what they've read. Or not go at all. That would be the worst. And so I think in this time where we are trying so hard to keep art alive, bring audiences in, particularly to the opera, which is what this subject is about specifically, I think it's really a big responsibility for everyone, including the critics and the reviewers, to find ways of reviewing pieces in a way that keep bringing audience members in and empowering them to have their own opinion about it. Because you're not going to get new audience unless they feel that they have the right to have an opinion about what they're seeing. And I think that's a fine line.
What would you say to young artists who have given a performance and they receive what they feel is a particularly devastating review? Mm-hmm. What would you say for them to try to move on?
Well, I mean, I would say, like, you know, what is it about the review that has particularly hurt you? And how do you feel about it? Because once you've read it, you've read it. You can't go back. You can't ignore what you've seen or what you've read. It's going to stick with you. So you have to make the choice to either move past it, do something with the information, or, you know, try as hard as you can to forget it. I mean, it's difficult. It's really difficult when you get a very bad review. I mean, I have been very fortunate that I have not had any scathing things, or at least I haven't seen them. But not everybody's going to like what I do. And I can't change that, you know, and if they do, I'm thrilled. And if I'm happy with what I'm doing, that's also a good thing. That's part of it. So I would probably say, you know, what did you enjoy about your performance? Were you happy with your performance? I mean, there are lots of times where somebody will say something about my performance or somebody else's performance, and they'll say, well, this part was a little bit not your best, you know. And I may be a little hurt by it at the moment, but if I really think about it, in that case, they may be right. It could just be at that moment it wasn't quite my best. And so then it comes into who's saying this to you, and who are they in your life, and do you trust them and their ears and their eyes? And I think that, I think for me, some of the best advice that I was given as I was studying was to develop that group of people that you trust. And you go finding new people in your life to kind of bring into that circle. But to really, to develop that and to talk to people and to seek out honest answers from the people that give them to you in a way that are constructive. And you know, and everybody's different. Some people are really good with blunt answers, and more power to them, you know. But those who are not, like me, I tend to, you know, I like people to tell me the truth, but to always be gentle.
What's a moment that stands out in your mind as being a performance that went particularly well, where you realized that this is what my life as a performer is about, where everything seemed to come together? Is there one moment that stands out for you?
I would say a couple of these last performances with Cherubino have felt really fun and wonderful. I can always pick something out that I don't want to do again, you know, or that I'm not negative about it on myself anymore, at least not with Cherubino. In the last few years, I think I've become a little bit more, lenient is not the right word. That voice, that critical voice, I've allowed it to just chill out a little bit during shows. And so then on a whole, you enjoy your time more on stage. So I can't think of any one specific moment, but I can think of lots of moments or just the feeling of being on stage that I enjoy. And part of it is knowing that there's this audience, but part of it is also those moments when there's so much light in your eye that you can't see anything at all. And so you actually see nothing but black and kind of dust in the air. And there's this, you have this sort of weird juxtaposition between feeling very small and very big. This is very weird, I know, sorry. It's kind of, I don't know if it's psychological or if it's just me being me. But there's something about that feeling where you know you're being watched, but because you can't see it, you're also invisible. So it gives you this great sense of being able to do anything. You know, you can just open up and be swallowed by this darkness. It sounds so dark. It's not dark. It's just this weird feeling of being able to just kind of fly.
Were you always able to do that on stage? Find that zone where you could just open up and be your best in that way?
From a child, I was in the Nutcracker for 2 seasons at City Center with the Joffrey when I was a child, and I loved it. I was very comfortable on stage. It never occurred to me not to be comfortable. I mean, there are always nerves as you're young and you're developing and you're growing, and I performed a lot when I was in high school and college. But, you know, even now when I do recitals, it's different with opera, there tends to be a lot of light in your eyes, but when I do recitals, I always ask them, say, can we boost the lights up just, you know, it's easier for me when I can't see the audience. There's something about being so close to somebody while you're performing that, I don't know, it's tricky. In some levels it's really lovely, and in others I find it hard because I feel that the gamut of it, of emotion and expression that I'm trying to show or portray is big. And I don't want it to seem like I'm, you know, hovering over people or imposing my feelings upon them. And maybe that proximity gives me that feeling. Although, of course, people who are, you know, in a small, like, dining room and you sing for them, they love it. I mean, so it's all personal, you know, feelings. But that feeling of being in a sort of a dark void. It's lovely.
Is it difficult to balance being a performer who travels and being a mother?
It's not easy. Anyone would tell you. Whether you have, you know, your husband there or not, it's difficult because I have to travel, you know. So for the first 3.5 years, my son traveled with me everywhere, which on one level, of course, is fantastic and necessary. But it causes a lot of, you know, organizational confusion. You know, it's like, who's coming with? A nanny? Am I getting a nanny there? Is a nanny traveling with us? Where do we stay? And every time I travel with him, you know, you need a bigger place to stay. So everything sort of gets upped to another level. You know, you need a bigger apartment. So you need to make sure you're also working so that you can pay for it. So you don't want to get sick. I mean, there, you know, the domino effect changes. But it is what it is, you know. I can't see my life differently now at all. And I love my son. He's awesome. He's got so much to say, and he's so interested in random things, and we sing together, and you know, and he's with me all the time. And if I have to go away for a short period of time, you know, he spends time with my mom, and you just make it work. I mean, it's funny, as if that were an option. It's not an option. You make it work. That's what you do.
You've been raising your voice for the awareness of prostate cancer. Mm-hmm. How did this come about?
This came about recently. I was talking to Kim Carrero, who's my publicist, and I said, you know, I want to get involved in an organization, in a charitable organization, and we discussed a little bit where I wanted to give my time. And one level, on one side, I will be working and giving my time to children's hospitals, but on the other, on a more public level, giving my time and voice to the Prostate Cancer Foundation. And we met with them recently and just actually filmed a public service announcement for them. And it's the reason behind all of it is because my father passed away from prostate cancer 11 years ago. And it was a part of my life. He had the disease for the majority of my life growing up. And it's part of my evolution. I was in college when my father died, and I would love to be able to empower women of any age to be more active in helping the men that are in their life get checked, to know a little bit more about the disease and what it means, and you know, different things, like they have to, the family has to know the history so that they know when they need to get checked. There are all sorts of different facets to it that we're starting to be involved in. And it's just a very important thing for me to be able to, in some ways, give back on all of those years that I was just an observer because I was so young. So of course I didn't have any decision making process for it. You know, I was just observing. It was all sort of happening in my life. And I think now that I've gone through most of my mourning, I think that it's nice to be able to get back into it and be a helpful voice of whatever help I can bring.
What are some of your upcoming projects? You have a new album coming out, and you also have some more Met broadcasts.
Rob Capello, who's a composer, set to music Polar Express and Gertrude McFuzz, which is a Dr. Seuss story. And I recorded the Dr. Seuss, Gertrude McFuzz, and I sing the role of a narrator in the piece. It's about a 15-minute long piece. And there's a young girl soprano who sings the voice of Gertrude McFuzz, who's this bird that has one tail feather. And she's desperate to have more than one, because Lalalee-Loo has more than one, and she's jealous. So I go on to explain that she finds her way in growing more feathers. And then by the end of the story, of course, the moral is she was actually happy with one feather, and she's left with just one at the end of the story. It's very cute, and it's very funny. But it allowed me also to record a piece that was not a classical, was not a completely classical piece. It's really more musical theater. It's a mix of styles. So I had a great time in the recording session. Played around a lot with my voice, got to do some funny accents and silly sounds. And I think this is exactly the direction that I'm trying to head when it comes to children and education, to get kids involved and interested in what sounds a classical singer can produce. Because it's not just opera. I mean, it's good singing. I think it's good singing, or healthy singing. And I think that's really important to educate, you know, young and not so young people what it is to just use your voice the way it was given to you. I think it's really important.
Are there roles you still dream of taking on in the future?
Well, yeah, but you know, I'm not a tenor or a baritone. I mean, I think I probably was a tenor in my last life or something. No, I would sing a lot of different roles. I mean, it would be super fun to sing Carmen one day, but it all depends on little factors and where my voice goes and whether to sing it with an orchestra that can probably, you know, not be too loud for now. I mean, you know, the voice changes as you evolve. So for me, whatever it is that I'm working on at any given time is most interesting because of the character, its evolution in the story, their arc, what they're doing, what they're saying, the words. I mean, it's so, the interpersonal relationships, the theater of it is really, I mean, that's why I'm here. It's because of the theater of it, the communication, the storytelling.
In your mind, what's the key to ensure that classical music survives through the next generation?
I brought my son and one of his preschool friends last year to see the dress rehearsal to Magic Flute that was in English, and they both sat for an hour and 40 minutes together and watched the entire thing.
It is possible.
It is more than possible. I think kids love to see an orchestra live. I think even big music institutions that are not solely educators can, I mean, and the Met does, you know, they bring in high school students and students to come and see dress rehearsals of appropriate operas, because like movies, not every opera is appropriate, right? There are rated R operas, I think, for a little later on in life. But there are plenty that are PG.
And you've made
PG-13.
some available. You appeared on Sesame Street
exactly,
and did
a
version of an Italian opera.
Exactly.
There.
I think we just have to keep on flooding any media that's available with the information and with the music, and not in a pretentious way, and not making it sound like it's something that's so different. It's just another form of storytelling. That's all it is. That's really all it is.
Isabel, thank you so much for being on Living the Classical Life. Thank you for your time, and we wish you much success with your future roles.
Well, thank you very much.
That was fun.
Yes.